Assalamu alaikum. Welcome to Study Al-Islam. This morning, we are, inshallah, continuing with the excellent study of the inner dimensions and understanding of the ascension or night journey of Prophet Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Prayers and peace be upon him. It is a humble honor to be here with you all again, the believers, this morning as your host today. My name is Sister Shahida Sharif, and I greet you all again with the greetings of peace of Assalamu alaikum. Inshallah, we'll begin with Al-Fatiha and our dua or prayer for learning. A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytan ar-rajim. Bismillahi ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Maliki yawm al-deen. Iyaka na'abudu wa iyaka nasta'een. Ihdina sirata al-mustaqeem. Sirata al-lazina anamta alayhim. Ghayru al-maghdubi alayhim walad-dalleen. Ameen. Inshallah, also want us to offer prayers for the community and those who recently returned to Allah in the recent tragedy in New Zealand, and for those who are wounded to heal, and for their families who have experienced loss. We are connected because we are one family, one human family, one ummah, one community because of Muhammad, the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, by Allah's permission. And so that unites us. And so we should be in prayer and be connected to what is going on, and to also be conscious and aware of how we can protect our communities and have discussions and check on each other, inshallah, because there are many still information more coming in with this recent incident, and we want to make sure that we're staying vigilant as a community, staying aware, staying connected, and just checking on each other to make sure each other are okay, because we are bashar, we are human beings, we have sensitivities, and we are connected to one another. We make the dua of learning. Allahumma alimna bima yanfa'ana wa infa'ana bima alimtana wa zidna ilman wa amilan mutakabbilan bi rahmatiki arhamar rahimin. O Allah, bless us with knowledge that is beneficial, and benefit us from that which you teach us, and increase us in knowledge and deeds that are acceptable to you, O merciful one of the ones who bestows mercy. Alhamdulillah. So as I said, I'm grateful to be here to continue in the conversation we've been having, and alhamdulillah, we have arrived and we have begun with the example of the ascension of our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, where he encountered the different prophets along the night journey. And alhamdulillah, we have arrived at the level of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Prayers and peace be upon him. And it's incumbent upon us to reflect deeply and internalize how the Prophet demonstrated how the Quran should be followed. So he is a model leader for us, a moral leader for us, and a human being for any people who are sincere, who are believing in God, believing in Judgment Day, and when we have to stand before God and account for how we were living in this world, this is the example that we have been given to look to. So he's a mercy for all the worlds, and the Quran itself is a mercy, so we have been situated to be able to receive this mercy. Now, alhamdulillah, the Prophet ﷺ was situated to be able to receive the Qur'an. So when we look into his life, historically before he received the Qur'an, we look to see how was he situated to receive this message, right? How did he conduct his life? And for the most part, we saw that he was someone who was trustworthy, he was upright, he was already on a path of belief of oneness of God. So he was rejecting all of the negativity that was around him. The condition of the community at that time was a state of ignorance, a state of darkness, and what they call the age of ignorance, or the age of jahiliya, or jahil, or lack of knowledge. And it was something that he rejected and he had to go away from. So that's something that we see is a condition that is being repeated. And so there is sometimes a necessity for us to go away from everything that's going on within this world. And we may not have to do that physically, but we can retreat even within ourselves. We can retreat within our own homes. But that means that we have to be a place of retreat, even within our own souls. So what is the condition of our soul? What is the condition of our homes? Is our soul a place of retreat? Do we feel at peace within our own selves? Or is there something that is pulling on us, tugging on us, or keeping us in some sense of discord? Or is there some sense of discord in our homes? And so for us to truly get into the life of Prophet Muhammad, we can go into the details of his life and look to see how did he conduct himself, how did he carry out his mission, so that we can take from that example to see how are we to be leading ourselves, leading our homes and our families and in our communities as well. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says in the Quran, in Surah Muhammad, in Surah 47, and that's Ayat 33, he says that أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم يا أيها الذين آمنوا أطيعوا الله وأطيعوا رسوله ولا تتلى أعمالكم. And this means, Sadaqallahu al-Azim, surely Allah speaks the truth. O you who believe, obey Allah and obey the Messenger, and make not vain your deeds. Meaning, make not everything that we do be in vain. Meaning, everything that we should do should have intention, should have purpose, and should have an outcome that has good, that is going to bring betterment to society, or betterment initially to ourselves and our families, and then to society. So Allah did not create us and just leave us to ourselves. He said, we have assuredly sent among every people a messenger. This is in Surah An-Nahl. An-Nahl, or the bee, Surah 16, Ayat 36. He says, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم وَلَقَدْ بَأَثْنَا فِي كُلِّ أُمَّةٍ رَسُولًا. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he didn't leave us hanging. He didn't leave us to our own selves. He created us, but he also sent us a messenger. And in this messenger, he gave us Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and those who came before him. But when we look at Prophet Muhammad, we're looking at him as a completion in this line of prophets. And he is also referred to as Al-Kamil, Kamil from the root word of Kaf, Mim, Lam, to be complete, to be whole. And so when we're looking at this example, we know that we're taking from a model and a holistic example of how we are to be in this world. And we are familiar, or we should be familiar with the ayat of Surah Ahzab, Surah 33, Ayat 21, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولُ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ لِمَنْ كَانَ يُرْجُو اللَّهَ وَالْيَوْمُ الْآخِرُ وَذَكَرَ اللَّهَ كَثِيرًا. Surely Allah speaks the truth. You have indeed, and this means you have indeed the messenger of excellent, a beautiful pattern of conduct, for anyone whose hope is Allah in the final day, and who engages much in the praise of Allah. So here it is, we're given conditions and we're given examples that if we're seeking Allah and His Messenger in the last day, then we need to be engaging much in the praise of Allah, and also too, we need to be working and making everything practical in our lives that it is exemplary or exemplified on our limbs, right? That we're not just people of faith who give lip service, but it's also evident on our hands, it's evident in our speech, it's evident in how we conduct ourselves and how we behave. And so all of this is connected. So when we study the life of Prophet Muhammad within context of revelation and or the history of revelation and how it unfolds, we begin to see him as this completion of the development of the human being, the development of the soul that began with Adam, right? So we began this whole journey almost 11 months ago, mashallah, beginning with this, with Adam, from that natural instinctive form of consciousness to an evolved and complete formed, fashioned with a solid foundation of a human being. And so we are looking at the Prophet ﷺ. Some say that he was on the eighth level, right? In that there are seven levels, and those seven levels inclusive of all those prophets that came before him when he ascended into the heavens. But he is a sign that even though that he could go higher than Ibrahim, going higher than that the level, it was for a single purpose. And for that purpose, it was to lead those who came before him, right? So showing that he was a completion of that, but also that it's not for him to stay there. So yes, he achieved that level, but there was nothing up there for him but to do that, and so he had to come back down, right? So Muhammad, although he's on the eighth level, there really isn't a level that we should be looking to define, more so that now it's time to implement and do the work, right? So Muhammad the Prophet, he's an example of the work. He is putting everything into motion. And so it's a condition that when we're studying each level and going back to each prophet and how we are to be refining ourselves, how we are to be conditioning ourselves, that when we get to that stage of that Ibrahim that is inclusive of all those things and coming to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that now we're at our level of adulthood and that level of prophethood, in the sense of we've reached that age of maturity and understanding in our development of our soul and in our brain and our understanding of our mind, our intellect, and our moral condition, and now it's time to put it to work. And so when we think about the evolution of the community of Imam Wafdi Muhammad and coming into al-Islam and the understanding that Imam Muhammad gave us through his study of the Quran and through his study of the Prophet ﷺ, that this community is at an age of 40-something. And so we should be producing that model community. We should be producing that model life that Prophet Muhammad exemplified in his time. And so it's time for us to do our work. We have been, we see it in pockets, and now it's time for us to come together in a communal sense where we're duplicating these efforts across the board, right? And so now it's time for us to refine our educational models, time to refine our business models, refine our cultural models, right? And refine our social, the way in which we interact with one another, so that we're becoming this balanced, proportion community. And so, as I said, it's not for us to stay isolated or in a cave or away from the people. It's time for us to come together with other people of like minds and spirits, as we have been doing, but in a more collective and uniform way. And so a lot of the initiatives that are being pushed, Muslims should be at the forefront, whether it's for the environment, whether it's for education. Our moral standards and our understanding of the Quran should be influencing how we're educating our next generations, right? If we look at the condition of the school systems, they're suffering, and they're looking for other models to improve upon what they have been doing or what they need to be doing. And so this is what we need to be doing, looking at how we can clean up our society. And the thing is, people are looking to the Muslims to do so. So even though we're looking at the media or what's going on, and we can easily say, oh, these things are negative, there's something good to come out of it. It's not by chance that the name of the area was Christ Church, a Christ Church mosque, that those words are being put together to show that we need to come together in unity. While that may not have been the original name of that town, that is something for us to pay attention to. So it's not by chance or by circumstance. And so we're to understand that from the ascension, we know that there were seven levels, and he didn't stay in the heavens. He came down to do the work. And so our pillars that the Prophet ﷺ modeled, we can see how we can start duplicating that into our lives, or moving beyond just our five pillars and making it become more practical for us and doing our community work. So for us, it's important that while we have to rebuild ourselves spiritually, right, and constantly be a reflection of Allah, constantly be in study, we're not to just stay there. We're actually supposed to be implementing that work. So we have to make sure we're coming together and planning together, studying, having more study circles together, so that we can make sure that we're all in alignment and understanding how we are to be conducting ourselves. And so within that, we're looking at how was the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, how was he a leader? How was he a business person? How was he as a father, as a husband, as an educator, as a strategist, right? To gain insights into how we should be conducting ourselves in our movement, in our speech, and how we make decisions. So the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he was an educator. He was a moral educator, and he was a liberator. So he was a freedom fighter, so to speak, of the soul. But how did he do that? We cannot expect to clean up our minds and our intellect if our moral condition has been denigrated. And if we look at the condition of the society that we're living in, the movement is to move away from morality, to move away from religion, to move away from everything. It's just to be nothing. There's no identity. There's no commitment to anything. And so with that means there's no obligation on the human condition to be responsible to one another, to be responsible for society. So it leaves room for Shaitan to come in with his schemes and to create chaos, if we allow that. So it's important for us to be studious and to be aware that we don't get caught up in these schemes that are going on, but that we are reflective and that we're being strategists, as the Prophet was, that even during times when there was contention within society, that there was a time for the Prophet Islam and the community to start planning, right? If we look at the history, we look at the Sirah in the time of the Treaty of Hudaybiyah, where the Prophet Islam, he relinquished a lot of things, and the companions were upset about it, where they thought they were losing out as the believers, when in actuality they were gaining. And so even though it may seem as though Islam is under attack or things are not going in the favor of the believers, there are people making their shahada attain on a daily basis. There are people who are coming to Islam in droves because they're investigating what is this way of life. And so who are they seeking out? Who are they coming to? It should be us as believers who have a clear understanding in our, not just in our words, but in our actions of how we're conducting ourselves. And so within that, we need to make sure when we're purifying ourselves, and when I say purifying ourselves, that we're purifying our lives and our actions based on the actions of Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So we will not be successful as a community until we're willing to be firm and to stand up and fight out the indecency in our lives, right? So if there's some sense of indecency that we're engaging in, or any type of bad morals or selfishness or arrogance, that this is something that we have to eradicate and root out from within ourselves. And we know those things that we battle with, that we struggle with. And if there's something that we need to seek out help professionally with, that's something that we need to do. We should not put ourselves in charge of institutions or masajid or organizations to help other people if we know we're suffering from certain weaknesses within ourselves, because we don't want to put ourselves in charge of others if we have not rectified our own condition. So let's make sure that we are willing to fight the indecency within ourselves. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that in the Quran. He reminds us to speak truth even if it be against our own soul, right? So that we are eradicating anything that can impede the progress of the collective, right? So if I know I have a large ego, if I know I have arrogant ways, if I know I am inconsistent in certain things, if I know I'm not praying consistently, if I know I'm not paying my charity consistently, all those things, whether it be from our pillars of Islam or if it be from our character, right? So we're looking at the example of the Prophet and how he was ethical, how he was intuitive, how did he govern in society. Now we have to start getting into the details of things. These are things that cannot be ignored if we're seeking to be successful as a model community. So we have to take charge of ourselves. If we're finding ourselves that we are suffering from sicknesses, suffering from diseases, then we have to take control of our appetites, take control of our diet, take control of our engagements. What are we engaging ourselves with, even with so many entertainment options now? People binge or go overboard with watching certain shows or things, and we have to make sure that we're not engaging in those things to the point where we're losing time that could be spent in something more beneficial. So how are we taking charge of ourselves? And when we take charge of ourselves, then we can take up responsibility for the whole society, right? Because we are accepting responsibility not just for ourselves and our families, but also for the whole society. So, and this is for the good of our children, for the future of our children, if we're really seeking to better and improve ourselves. So how is it that we're studying the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam's life, and how are we internalizing that within our own, right? The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he did not overeat. He did not engage in certain behaviors that will keep him up late at night unless it was for prayer, right? So he made sure that there was a balanced way in which he conducted his life. He didn't spend his life in sleep, in slumber, no. He took his time for sleep, and that was in the night, but he also woke up for prayer. So how is our night prayers? How is our tahajjud, right? If we talk about being spiritual warriors or activists or workers within the community, then that means we have to have a spiritual reservoir, and that means we're building it We're building it on a constant basis. We're keeping ourselves in tune and engaged with Allah because we are constantly purifying our hearts, purifying our actions, and filling it with the word of Allah, meaning that we are engaged in study of the Quran, we are engaged in study of the life of the Prophet, and we're also doing dhikr and remembrance of Allah, but we're also acting upon it. So when I'm engaging with people in the public, my speech reflects that remembrance of Allah. So it's not just for me to be remembering Allah and I'm not reflecting it in my speech. So it's important for us to do that, inshallah. Also, for how did the Prophet ﷺ, how did he engage with his family as a father and as a husband? And when I say that, I'm looking at what kind of family did he produce, right? And we want to be successful in the community, but our families are suffering. That's backwards. We won't be successful in the community. We'll have to be successful in our families first. So first, once we clean up ourselves and clean up our own condition and daily work to improve upon our discipline and our evaluation of ourselves and our accounting of ourselves, then what are we producing within our families? When we look at the Prophet ﷺ's family, we can look at to his daughters, we can look to his wives and see excellent examples of those who are not just conscious of God, but they engaged in society in a way that was critical in the development of the community. Fatima, upon her be peace, the daughter of the Prophet, she was one of his youngest daughters, but she was always known to be engaged in the remembrance of Allah, even as she worked, even as she, and she was in the house of Ali, radiallahu anhu, her husband, who was also the cousin of the Prophet, and they produced two grandchildren, Hassan and Hussein, and they were known to be leaders in the community. So what kind of fruit are we producing these days? Are we making sure that they are in obedience and devout to Allah, even without our constant interjection? Are they doing things on their own? Are they checking themselves? Are they conscious of Allah on their own? Are we being a model for them to do that? So this is where we have to really start dissecting the life of Prophet Muhammad, not just for the sake of how our souls ascend and stand before Allah on the Day of Judgment, but how are we conducting ourselves in this life, in this world right now? How are people seeing us? Are we just moving and going with the flow, being moved by every headline, every entertainer, every celebrity? You know, it's important for us to take stock of what is our focus, what is our aim, and what is our goal. If our aim is Allah and His Messenger in the last day, then we have to align ourselves with that. And what does that look like? That means we have to take a magnifying glass or just take a deeper look at ourselves. Where am I? And not just we're trying to be perfect, only Allah is perfect, but we're seeking excellence in everything that we do, right? And so that means we're preparing ourselves for that day of accounting by taking account of ourselves right now. And that's actually a saying of Umar radiallahu anhu. He said, "Tahasibu anfusikum qabla an yuhasibukum." To take accounting of yourself before the day of accounting, the day of hisab, the day in which your deeds will be brought forth before you. And so, when I say let's look at ourselves and look at our families, those are the first that we're instructed in the Quran to save from the fire. Qu anfusikum wa ahwalukum min an-nar, right? And we know that the nar is the fire, and that's the truth. It's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says the fire is true. The fire is real. So we're not to think that it's some type of fake fire that we're talking about, that there's going to be a real punishment if we don't take stock of what's going on in our lives right now and accept that responsibility, that we have to look at the model of Prophet Muhammad as a completion of the excellent form of our soul and our human development, and that I can take from that. I may not receive prophethood, but God will reveal things to me that I am obligated to do within society, right? So we think that in order to be like Muhammad, I have to be this pious person walking around and no one can touch me. No, I should be approachable. I should be accessible. I should be humble in my movement and in my walk and in my engagement in society. I should be able to move with the Christians, move with the Jews, move with those people, even those people who say they don't believe. I can be able to engage with them to a point where they'll start to think and prick their consciousness into belief and understanding. And it's important for us to be guiding our families to be the same. And if there's discord that's going on within our hearts and in our souls, that we're we have to get to the heart of what that is and look to the model of Prophet Muhammad to how did he rectify these things. And sometimes we have to sit with those things in silence. We have to retreat and seek understanding for what is going on within our homes and within our families. And we see the condition right in front of us. And after that, after we're working on ourselves and our families, and we look to our communities, we see that the African-American communities are suffering from sicknesses, dying from ignorance, just not knowing. So how are we introducing and engaging them in a way that is bringing them to a higher sense of morality and a higher sense of living and a better way of life? That is our job and that is our task, and it's not something that is difficult when we actually submit to this way of life and this way of living. In that I am willing to remove any indecency and immorality in my life. And even if that is in how I am engaging within my own personal time, within myself, or with my family, in my speech, in my words, in my actions, in all those things. And then also, and I'm going to go as far as to say, into what we're consuming. We have to be conscious of what we're consuming as a collective, because there was a time when our community ate to live. We eat to live, and as our community still does, and we have to revisit those principles in order to make sure that we are rooting out anything that is keeping us from being progressive, right? Because we have to know that those things that we're consuming impact us greatly and severely, and we're seeing a high elevation and rise in the rates of diseases that didn't exist before, but they're being brought about because of what we're eating, what we're consuming. So let's make sure that as a collective and as a community, we take charge of our individual health as well as our collective health. And that is important, because how can we say we're people of spirit and high morale and we're unhealthy? That's very serious. And for our children to model after that, it's very serious for us. And so it's important that we're cultivating a level of obedience and discipline and self-restraint. Not just waiting until Ramadan to fast, but that we're also fasting from these things throughout the year. Things that are taking us out of our balance, because for us to get to a place where we see ignorance all around us, and we're trying to be that moral educator and that moral liberator to bring about a higher intellect within the people and to not see our communities and our society decline, then we have to take a hard stance with ourselves and a harder look at how are we negotiating and navigating our lives with the Quran. Are we waiting until situations arise and then I'm going to go to the Quran and reference it for an argument? Or is this my daily reflection, my daily guide, my daily resource that I'm using to check myself against, right? And that's important for us to do that. And also, too, that how did the Prophet ﷺ, how did he enact justice, right? How did he administer justice? Oftentimes in our experiences, we are not rooted in our faith to the point where we can administer justice fairly, and so we allow for things to happen within our community that mount up, and it becomes a sickness and a problem that's prevalent. And so this means we have to be firm in our faith. We can't obey ourselves. We have to obey justice. We can't obey ourselves, we have to obey Allah. And so when we remove ourselves from obeying just our inclinations and what we're feeling, and we're obeying Muhammad the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and we're obeying his example, then we can obey ourselves, right? And if we're in alignment with that, because we can't be weak when we're trying to administer justice. We have to be firm, and we have to be clear, and we have to be direct. Because Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala will support us in righteousness and in truth when we're exacting or delivering justice for our communities. Because this is a time where we have to clean things up. We have to clean ourselves up, we have to clean up our families, and we have to clean up our communities. We're really in a state of a trial where we're going to be tested as those were tested before us, so that we can stand for this test because we are at a maturity level of clear understanding, a maturity level of Muhammad thinking, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, where we can actually begin to live out and express this moral human development in every facet of society. We're not limited in any way at any point anymore. We are a free people. We are a liberated people, not just physically, but mentally and spiritually. So the only chains that we put upon ourselves is the one that we subject ourselves to when we're not following the Quran, when we're not following the model of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So in order for us to be that fully evolved human being, high-thinking intellectual, that means we have to be morally sound. We have to be morally rooted and morally balanced, inshallah. And that is my prayer for us individually, for us and our families, and for us collectively as an ummah, inshallah. Again, I pray for those who lost their lives tragically and those who have been affected by it, and reach out to your brothers and sisters and check on each other and make sure that we are staying connected and staying rooted in the Sunnah of Prophet Muhammad and the Uswa is excellent.